Thank you. Hello, everyone. We'll edit that out. Right. So this is kind of the beginning of the more detailed part of our meeting. And so a little bit, I wanted to motivate what we're going to focus on for the next three workshops today, and then Tuesday and Thursday of next week, because it was implicit in what got said yesterday, or sorry, on Tuesday, but maybe it wasn't completely clear. And I use a metaphor that I used at a recent computational biology meeting in, people are starting to show up, it's clear, meeting in the UK. The meeting was on AI and bioimaging. And so to some degree, you know, the goal of the meeting was ostensibly to have this fountain of knowledge where we have, you know, deep neural nets and we can learn things. What the meeting ended up focusing on, though, was largely research data management. So how do we build up a reservoir of information, of data that we can all use for deep learning, right? So we're approaching things as from where we are today. And eventually we'll get to the fountain of knowledge, but we're not there yet. But from the OME point of view, there's also there are other details that are even deeper and darker. You know, there's pipelines to get water into the reservoir and then pump it to this fountain. And that's where we often find ourselves, right? We have it, you know, have done this for many years, run this building of infrastructure. And much of what got talked about on Tuesday, on day one, what was about the reservoir. What, you know, Omero is this way to build up a repository of your data that you can prepare your analyses with. Sorry, people are still showing up. And it's also what sits underneath the IDR. And Francis gave you kind of all these examples of data that we're collecting, and maybe that triggered someone who's here or could trigger your users, you know, with ideas of what they could further analyze. But it's obvious we still have things we need to do on kind of the lower level. And that's what we're going to focus on for the next couple of days. So kind of the goal of research data management and the overview of that Jason and Francis and Chris gave to you on day one. But we're going to get into the details from here. And the question really that we're asking is, whereas the current state of the art is that you can upload your proprietary file formats to one of these repositories, it's exactly what happens with the IDR, or the Bioimage Archive. I'm just checking if Matthew's here this evening. But your users are left, while you or your users are left downloading those files as they currently exist, and then you need to still perform some kind of translation, for example, with bioformats, to get your work done. And the hope would be that we could come up with something as a community so that when you're accessing the data and in these reservoirs of information, that you no longer need to do that, that we've somehow agreed on a common specification so that this all gets easier and faster and less of a burden on all of you, i.e. that we have better pipes. So that's really the idea behind the next generation file formats. This is kind of a diagram to get across what they are, but at the end of the day, it's really about taking kind of complex binary data and opening it up and making it more accessible so that it becomes an API that all of our tools can access. And that's done really by having the metadata, the descriptions of the information in a open readable format. So that's almost always JSON. Having a well-defined layout for the data so that you no longer need to parse through a long opaque file to figure out where your individual chunks of data are. And that there are certain knobs that you can tune. You can change the chunk size, how big each of these atomic pieces of your data are, how are they compressed, how many dimensions are there, et cetera. But while keeping the same API. And through doing that, ever more clients are then able, so visualization tools, which we're going to hear about today, are able to access the same representation of the data. We were actually talking right before everyone showed up about, we're not exactly sure. So you're going to see, so kind of a list of, I think it's what, five or six clients today that can do this. Where were we a year ago at the last meeting? We're not exactly sure, but we think it's three. And so we're definitely seeing growth, and it's very exciting for us to have all of you here, and kind of maybe there are even tools that some of you want to present that we haven't heard about yet. Yes, you can have the slide, and also these images are available on GitHub. So I will paste all that once I'm done talking. Next week on Tuesday, I'll be talking about metadata. So how are we going to represent all of our bioimaging metadata in this kind of new container? And then on Thursday, we'll be talking kind of about the details of OME Czar in Java land. So really, how can we build better libraries for implementing MOBI? So if you're interested in that, by all means, feel free to show up. And with that, I will, thank you, Norman. And with that, I will pass over to Jean-Marie and Peter and Will, who've prepared everything for today. And just say again, it's great that everyone's here. All right, take care.
Thanks, Josh. I'm going to share the screen. Okay. So yes, the aim of this session was to, as Josh indicated, to see what are the viewers that are supporting NGFF. So for that, we prepare a table that we are going to explain. So sorry for the people that attended this morning. I know there are a few, so they might feel that as a repeat. We'll go through some demo of some of the tool, and after that, discuss what are us people that are needed for the people developing viewer, and what also even they can also mention what are the next phase of support for NGFF. So it's kind of an open floor. So for that, first of all, for the testing, we have used public data. So we have a catalog of public data. We have converted some images from IDR, the image data resource, into AGFF. So they are available. We have some sample data available from various version of the specification. You can find, you know, we have tried to be as exhaustive as possible at times if they have a label, what are the size, if you're looking for multi-channel, multi-T, multi-Z, et cetera. So, and this morning during the session, we were aware of some people pointed out some file. There is, we have added them to the GitHub issue. So if you go to NGFF issue 140, we have started to record that, because what we want ultimately is to have a location where everybody could insert some public data, could insert a link to public data, I should say, or a catalog similar to what we have. So people, when they're looking for sample for testing, they tool either for visualization, analysis, can find what they need. So sorry, before we go to the table, what for the audience is probably worth mentioning that it's early days for everything. So it's early days for the specification. So we're on version 0.4. And as Josh indicated last year, we probably had three viewers that was supporting the specification. And now we're probably at 7 or 8 now, which is very exciting, but obviously the job is not done. So everybody has to be patient and welcome to able to help either by testing, submitting PR and pull requests, and basically helping to move that effort forward. So let's have a quick look at the table. So we have built into so if you go to something called NGFF tools, we looked at various viewer and we evaluated how they support some aspect of the specification. So the key point for the table is green, the file open, and the feature of the specification is supported. Yellow, we could open the file, but the feature in the specification feature is not supported by that viewer. And red, we couldn't open the file at all. So that's a problem. And gray is we managed to open the file, but we were not sure if the feature was supported or not. It could be a bug, but with a sample we have picked. So there was a bit of uncertainty into what we were looking into. So there are a few reasons for building that table. Is first giving an idea for people when they are looking for a viewer to validate what they are doing, to compare what I think Norman used the term ground truth this morning. So we'll be very pleased if that become the ground truth, but we are still a long way of being being there. But I think that's a kind of idea. If, for example, if somebody building a new viewer want to know that like Mobi is supporting Axis VO3, or then they can look at the file how it should look like, and then they can implement it into their own application. And also for people writing OMEZAR, if they want to test or inserting a feature in the viewer, they can test with some sample that we know are working for some viewer. So how is it organized? So you have on the part feature, this is section of the specification. So if you mouse over the little eye icon, you will have more information, but labeled. So that's one of the pretty explicit. You have a link to some sample data. So all those data are publicly available. The little tick is mean that the file is validated. My colleague Wilmore will present what we call the NGFF validator. So that's validating the ZAR file, the container, I should say, itself, and see if it's support is written according to the specification. In some of the cell, you will see a little eye icon. So that means you can open, if you click on it, you can open the image into the corresponding viewer. So that work well with some viewer, the viewer that are web-based viewer, like Vizar, for example. In the case of Napari and Mobi, that are client, desktop client application, this is not possible, but we're discussing possible solution for that, even having link into notebook or something like this down the line. If you see if the feature, in that case, the label feature, for example, for Vizar, has no effect, but you will see a GitHub logo. That's mean an issue has been created, or even a pull request could have been submitted. So this is potentially in the pipeline, or if you want to follow what's happening onto this file and to this viewer, you can do so. And for the one that are kind of gray, we are trying to explain what was happening. If, for example, the file could open, but we saw some images are kind of pixelated or not all resolution were loaded, so we couldn't make our mind up here. So that's been my colleague, myself, Peter Valchesko, and Will Moore have worked on that table. So we did all the testing. So by no means we are expert of those tools. So the feature might be there, and the people developing the tool might tell us we were incorrect and help us out here. So if you want to contribute to that that page, help, more than welcome. So the link is at the bottom of the page. So if you go to basically OME NGFF tools, you will find the GitHub repository. So from the morning discussion, we had the discussion this morning, there's already some issues that have been created of indicating which source of the data is the tool opening local file, but only S file on S3, etc. So this is a nice feature we'll be adding to the table, because that's very relevant for people developing tools as well. So before finishing, I will just we'll go through a series of demo. So now we have more people. Sorry if you look at the video, Christian, I tried to explain quickly Mobi after I saw your email, because and obviously that will open only a file or two in Mobi. So that was not going to be as a slick presentation as you will do today. So a disclaimer of what we have presented, we showed it, what we're showing this morning. So I will pass it to my colleague Will Moore, who is going to show us validator and Vizar. And please feel free to ask questions or stop us at any point.
Okay, thanks for the intro. So I'm just gonna pick up where Jean-Marie left off on this table and to show you some of these links here, which link to this tool that Jean-Marie mentioned, OMI NGFF validator. So that's these little checks here that will open each of those files in this tool. And you can see, if you want to point this at some different source to validate, you can see that the source is specified in the URL here. So you can point this at any public sample or even one you've hosted locally. And I'll do a bit of a demo of that later. So this tool has kind of two functions, really. One, as the name suggested, is to validate files. And the other is to serve as kind of an inspector tool where you can poke around the data and see what the file an NGFF image really is. And I'll go through some of that with this tool. So it basically starts off by loading this top level metadata file for an NGFF, which is a Z-ATRAS. That's the name of the file. So it loads this, and this is a JSON file that contains, it's what's shown here, and it contains the basic the metadata for the NGFF image. And this is JSON data, and the top level object here is this multi-scales, which pretty much defines what an OMI NGFF is. In this browsing tool here, you notice if you hover over some of these items, there's a little information, little icon here. If you click on that, it will open
It looks like, can everybody see? Because Cola indicated he can't see the presentation. Okay. It's no longer the slides or presented. So Will was presenting a tool. Can everybody see that? We're currently at the page called specification page.
Okay.
So it seems that everybody can see you except maybe Cola, I think.
Okay.
Sorry for the interruption, Will.
No problem. Okay, so I'm looking here. This has opened the appropriate version of the spec at the in this case at the multi-scales metadata section, and a few of those links will do the same thing to give you more information about the specific parts of this metadata. So the multi-scales is this top level. It contains a version, and what this tool is doing is using that version to load to generate a URL to the schema. And these schemas are all hosted on GitHub, and it loads that schema and then uses that schema to validate this data in the browser. And that's what you're seeing here with this big green check, is that validates. If it doesn't, if some of these data types are of the incorrect type or essential metadata is missing, then you'll get an error here, and it should give you some information about what how the validation failed. So this multi-scale is a list. Typically, we only have a single item in this list, and this contains some metadata about the image as well as the specification for the multi-scales levels of the pyramids. So we've got some axes information here. This is a four-dimensional image, X, Y, Z, and C channels, and the units and the types of those axes. And then the data sets. So in each data set, these are, as I said, levels of the pyramid, and then they start with the largest, highest resolution level. And each item has a path, as well as some other metadata here, coordinate transformations, which can have things like scaling information in them. But the path is essentially gives you a path to the next level in the hierarchy, and for each of those paths on the right hand side here, you'll see a ZAR array, which is the data for that level of the pyramid, and these are validated as well. It does some checking that the dimensions here are the same size as the number of axes and that sort of thing. So the information shown here is some critical information about the ZAR array itself. It's got the dimensions of the array, as well as the sizes of the individual the chunks on disk. So each of these, and this little cube here, gives an idea of a display of those dimensions. And you can see the individual chunks are individual files on disks. And you can see the size of the array on disk as well as the size of each chunk. So this is the highest resolution, the largest dimension. And then as you go down here, you'll see smaller sizes of each level of the pyramid. And there's the, you can inspect the actual ZAR Z array data for each of these levels as well. So that's it's basically just a tool for validating, as well as just inspecting all these things and you know, working out what's going on with your file and debugging and that sort of thing. So that's a single image. I'll show another example or two here. There's a high content screening plate, which is also included in the OMIGFF specification. In this case, the top level Z Atara's file contains plate metadata. It specifies the wells and columns and the acquisitions of the plate. And again, it's validated by the plate schema here. And as on the right is shown kind of the wells of the plate laid out in the grid. And it's validating here initially just the well itself and the first image in each well. You can choose a different image to validate, or in fact, you can validate all the images for each of those wells. This hierarchy is also browsable. You can browse to a particular well and bounce to an individual image within each well. Okay, so that's kind of an overview of that tool. And I'll move straight on to, I'm going to mention briefly the another kind of type of layout for the data, which is this bioformats to raw layout. So if I click on this, this is really a wrapper, an extra layer around individual OMI NGFF images. So you can see that this contains three images in the next level of the hierarchy. The top level contains just this bioformats to raw layout, which specifies that this is the format being used here, and it also contains an OMI metadata XML file, which contains the metadata for these three images. So this is the format generated by the bioformats to raw tool. And each of these, you can browse again down to each of these individual images within that hierarchy. Okay, so that's NGFF validator. I'm gonna just also briefly show Vizar, which is a browser-based tool for viewing NGFF or images. So this is developed by Trevor Mance at Haverford Med School. And it's a multidimensional viewer here, basically loading a plane at a time, moving through Z and T. If there's a multi-T image, there'll be another slider here. Loading the channels, and it's using the Merry metadata from the ZAR file to color these channels and to name these appropriately. And as you zoom in, if this is a high resolution image, you'd load different resolutions as you zoom in. I'm just going to show one other type of data in Vizar, which is a plate. So if I click on this Vizar column for this high content screening, this loads a whole plate of data. It's using the lowest resolution data for each of these images to show this plate layout. And so actually it's possible to still scroll through Z and again scroll through T of these for time-lapse images. And I can adjust the rendering settings. So this is not like thumbnails, these are actually rendering the raw data of these. And I can browse through these wells by clicking on an individual well that will open in a second, open the full resolution images within that well. It takes a second for each of those to load. It will do. Okay, so these are full resolutions of these images that are contained within that well. And then again, I can browse between from down to a single image. Okay, so that's pretty much covers everything I wanted to show for Vizar. And I'll hand back to, I think Peter's gonna give a demo of Napari next.
Yeah, I don't think we have anybody. Joel is not here this afternoon. So yeah, if Peter, you can do the Napari plugin for Vizar.
Absolutely.
Unless the question for the validator, I know Ken was asking a question in the chat that has been answered. Is the question regarding the validator or Vizar? Okay, go ahead, Peter.
So, hello. I'm just jumping in for the short demo of Napari. Napari is a multi-dimensional image viewer for Python. It's a desktop-based application, and it's built upon the Python scientific packages SciPy and NumPy. And it's capable of annotating, analyzing, and browsing large multi-dimensional images. We had a very nice demo in the morning session. I would strongly recommend to complement watching of that demo. I'm sure that my colleagues would be able to give in the chat the exact time point on the already published recording, where Joel Luthi was showing some features, especially in the plate workflow. But let me start not with plate, but saying that Napari is capable of opening the OME and GHFF both locally, which is something I will start with, as well as from S3, which I will show in the next step. So you can see that I have here a couple of local OME and GFFs, and I will simply open them once I activated my Conda environment, where Napari and the Napari Omero plugin is installed. And this is a necessary plugin for viewing of the OME and GFF. And this is done by simply executing Napari and the name of the OME and GFF. And this will open locally on my Mac a Napari. It's just coming up with this OME and GFF in it. It is a multi-T, multi-Z image. The lower bar is multi-T. I will slide it to the very left so that I am on the first time point. I will slide the Z bar more to the left. You will see in a second why I'm doing that. And I will adjust a little bit rendering settings, which is done on the top left, such as so. Okay. So that I have a better overview. When I will add in a second a second image for you. Okay. Like this. Looks much cleaner. And just watch the image. I will zoom in onto this cell a little bit. And in Napari, we have a console. So I am opening that console inside the Napari itself by clicking on the button on the bottom left. And I will open a second image. in Napari in the same viewer, and the second image will be overlaid over this one. The second image I'm showing for two reasons. First of all, it will come from S3 bucket, so this is a different location than the one I just opened locally. And secondly, it has a very good relation with the first image, namely the second image was created from the region of interest, which was on this first image, and the region of interest encompasses this cell, and it was simply converted into another OMI NGFF file, and that file has a transform in it which tells it where to put the OMI NGFF czar with relation to the underlying image I have already opened. Hopefully this is not too confusing. I will use something which we have luckily here. It's just a sheer luck that I can simply copy this link, which is in the OMI NGFF tool Napari example, which was just introduced by my colleague Will Moore. And I will paste that link into my Napari console. Can you hear me? Thank you. Sorry. Because sometimes people don't move their heads too much, and that's quite unnerving. And what you can see is that here appeared the advertised second image overlaid on top of the second one. I just have there a layer which is completely black, and that's why you can see the black square, hopefully. And if I select and deselect, you can see now what I'm talking about. You can see that the overlay is appearing and disappearing. And this is because the bottom channel is completely black, which is not too bad to get the overview. I think if I go to the Psi4 channel, that's the most interesting one with regards to features. You can see now the features coming up. And if I now play with the black channel, I switch it. Okay. On and off. And with the Psi4 channel, you can see now nicely, hopefully, and understand what I'm trying to show here. And this is that I have the second image overlaid in a correct position over the first one. And once more, the coordinates, the offset in X and Y for that second image are written inside that very OMI NGFF of the second image. Okay, so this shows the translation feature, which Napari is nicely supporting and also capable of showing on two images. Now, I will quickly show a plate, and that's easily done by going to the table itself and grabbing the link from the sample data example on the HCS plate line. And I will copy that link, and I will close the Napari and go again to my command line and do Napari that link. Okay, so hopefully you understand what I've done. And again, I'm doing something which is quite complementary to the morning workflow, where Joel was showing that you can also drag and drop files to Napari, but I chose not to learn it in those couple of hours because, of course, it's asking for a disaster. And we are waiting for the plate to load, so I'm just showing what I know. And the feature here to acknowledge is that Napari is first is able to view the plate. And secondly, if I now zoom in, you will have to bear with me. This is because the pyramidal levels and the higher resolutions for all of the images in those wells, you always see only the first image in each well, are being loaded, and this takes a little bit of time. Okay, and I would really invite you to view the first video where Joël is going into depth and showing also some prototype of the work of the Napari crew, which is trying to address exactly this issue with all the questions. And I would like to stop my Napari demo right here and thank you for your attention. Pass the word back to Jean-Marie. Thank you.
Thanks, Peter. Any question? As I say, we're not necessarily expert in everything, but so as you realize, this is Napari is a desktop application. So Will was presenting something bizarre, which is JavaScript. This is more Python. And the next presentation will be Christian, which is also going to show us a desktop application, Mobi, which is a Fiji plugin. Christian, the floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. I will share my screen. I put the document for this in the notes. So if you want to do this at home, you can try. So yeah, this is work of many people. Here the backend technologies are Java, N5, ImageLib 2, and Big Data Viewer. And what you would need as a user is Fiji and the Mobi update side. So what this plugin currently supports is, as Petter just said, so we can also open from the file system or from S3, and we can also open from S3 with some credentials. So if you don't want to share the data with everyone but want to password protect it, that's also possible. I will show you one example now from also from S3, because it's actually too big for my computer. So I will open an OME SAR from S3, and it has this web address. And what you see is here on the left is actually how it's reading all these individual chunks from S3. So I always find this interesting to see. So then if you zoom in more, you see it has to load now other stuff from the higher resolution levels. You can hear just, so there could be multiple images. You can change the color and all the usual stuff. So what's special about Big Data Viewer maybe is that you can also do this arbitrary plane slicing stuff. So you can reorient really in 3D and then look at the thing in other orientations. And I think right now it's one of the tools that performs best with this big data, but I'm curious about what the Napari guys are up to. Maybe they can also do that in the near future. Okay, then I want to show kind of two sneak previews. So what people are working on right now is to have for OMEZAR also annotated segmentations. Yeah, so that we can have tables that say which segments have which features. So right now that's not yet possible, but we have that here already in our Mobi specification. So I can just show how that will look like. I hope in a not too far future also in just pure OMEZAR. So we host some of this metadata right now on GitHub because we can't put it yet in OMEZAR because the spec is not ready. So this is the same data as before, but now I will add some cell segmentation on top. And then you can have this kind of stuff where you have a table and then the segmented cells on top, and you could look at this. And do also things like, for example, if you think this is a particularly interesting cell, you could click there and then it would go there in the image and stuff like that. So this would be possible once we have this table specification for label images in SAR, which I hope will be soon. And then finally, I want to give another preview. So what we are also working on in the Czar community is having a bit more transformation specification than just the nice translation that Petter showed you, but also rotations and scaling, all of that. And I think then what Josh just said, so there should be also a specification that you not have just one image, but several, right? So image collections. And then actually something that I think we didn't discuss yet in Czar, but I think we can also add at some point, is the idea that you can annotate an image, right? Maybe you can say something about what's in that image. So let's say we would have all of that. I would like to show how what we can do then. And I think we will probably have these things at some point. I will open a different data set here. So this is a EM grid, but we can now, like there's just this idea that there could be an image collection, right? So you have not just one, but maybe you have a whole CLEM data set. Maybe with annotations. So here, for example, is now a well where the researchers took more data, took also fluorescence data and some high resolution tomograms, which are colored here according to this annotation. So now let's, for example, say I'm really interested in mitochondria. Okay, then I would see, okay, I want to go to this data set and then I can browse there and zoom in. Maybe I remove this overlay for a second. Then you can appreciate maybe. So maybe some of you can really see that there are mitochondria, EM experts. And this is also still actually, so this is 3D data. So one could also look from the side because these tomograms are actually a little bit 3D also. Yeah, so that's basically, like if we have this transformation specification, we can do fuse, or you could store fuse like that in an OMI Czar and then share this with your collaborators. I think that's the idea. Okay, and this was already my little Mobi demo. Are there any questions?
Thanks, Christian. A question that came up this morning because I was doing a. You have the option of export to OMI Czar, so that was easy to export from an Image Plus object. Ah. But is that coming? The question was if you have, for example, an image already in Big Data Viewer, which is not necessarily an OMI Czar, can you also pick an image from the Big Data Viewer to export as OMI Czar?
So what actually we also have here now is if you right click somewhere, then you can say show raw images. And then you can, if it's multi-resolution data, you can choose which level you want. And then it will open this as a normal Image Plus, and then you could export it, yeah. But that only works if right now, if you load the stuff via our framework, which means that it was already OMI Czar. There's no feature in normal Big Data Viewer for that, I think.
Okay. So the step is to go via the Image Plus object from ImageJ in order to export if you open. Yeah, okay, that's good because I
think that's the current status. Yeah, I mean, Josh might know more, but I think that's what it is. Yeah,
thanks. That looks very exciting. So, any question or comment?
And thank you.
Is Matt or Paul from Gateway ITK? So whoever want to demo. So we didn't look at it this morning because we didn't feel that we'd be able to demo. So we'll, for people who couldn't attend this morning, we'll indicate where they can find it in the video when it's posted on our YouTube channel.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Yes, thank you. And sorry we didn't make it this morning. It was
understandable.
You wouldn't want to see us at that stage. So yeah, thank you for the opportunity to be with you and talk with you here. And I put a link to some of the slides related to the demo in the chat. And this is work that I'm doing together with my colleague Paul Elliott, who's also here on the chat here. So if you have more questions, please talk to us. And this is describing the ITK widgets, ITK VTK viewer features for NGFF. And this is a native web-based viewer for large scale, the scientific data that we have. And I'd like to give you a few demos of some cool things that we can do with NGFF based on the viewer. Also describe and share how we are really gung-ho with OME and NGFF and Czar, and how the viewer is really architectured around the format in a nice way. And then describes some things that are coming in the future that are in progress now, and great opportunities for collaboration and features to work together on them. So there's a link in the notes next to Christian's links there too. And also I put in the chat, please do steal these slides if you like to, but also reproduce them locally as we go through them here. There's a few data sets from the table that was presented we can look at. And then there's also a brainstem data set that's in NGFF on AWS. It's neat because it's 300 gigabytes or so we can work with. And then also there's a few examples working with local images that we'll look at. But a few cool things, really cool things, is the volume rendering support that you can get on the web with these data sets. So we have some very good volume rendering features to get a good understanding of what information is in the data, using gradient opacities and scattering and lighting and shadowing. And we're working on improving that too.
Matt? You're not sharing your screen right now. Is that on purpose?
Oh, I'm not. Okay. Yes. Thank you. Thank you. That would help.
You just take this on faith. It's amazing, right?
My descriptive powers are not that good, but we should probably have some visualization with the visualization demo. Okay. So yeah, maybe this is a little better. This is the volume rendering. Yeah. A lot better than my description here. And then also, right, the natural multi-scale support that comes with OME and GFF. So what happens with the viewer is it will progressively load the data, so you get the lower resolution quickly, and it will update the resolution based on the rendering capabilities of your system, that if you're doing local rendering, client-side rendering, and load progressively until you get to a higher scale. You can also select to scale explicitly, and you can also select regions of interest. And then within that region, it's just the resolution will be increased, like was shown with Mobi, similar. It's not quite as fast as Mobi, but we're always working on improving it. And then we are really gung-ho in supporting the features of OME and GFF. In particular, we're developing and using this in projects for registration of images. So spatial metadata is very important to the work we're doing. So everything is done in world coordinates, and you have scale bars at work, but also having the opportunity to bring together different types of data in the future is the goal. And we are really excited and trying to build this around OME and GFF. So if you're using it in the web browser and you have a Czar OME data set, it will directly fetch from that data set as an OME and GFF Czar. We have lots of these different types of data sets in our test suite now. If you come in and you have many of the different formats supported by ITK, which is lots of different scientific formats, dozens, we will build the equivalent multi-scale pyramid do the filtering properly so you get a nice anti-alias pyramid of the data. So if you click on the, if you go to the website of the viewer, you can just click and load data that's available locally, a TIFF file or other types of files. And in WebAssembly, it's going to chunk and build a multi-scale pyramid so that even if the data is fairly large, you're able to render it optimally with the capabilities of your local client. And we also support communicating from Python too. And this could be, we've been working Jupyter notebooks, but also JupyterLab. And we've also had to do some work to add support for tools that are used often for AI-based development. So Google Colab, and we're working with the AWS SageMaker folks. And then also if you have just a WebSocket, you don't want to do something Jupyter-ish, you can do that too. And this is coming from our collaboration with the MJoy project Way and the just fantastic work that's done there. So communicating from JavaScript to Python in a very natural way. And again, if you have a ZAR store in Python, it will directly pass that from the remote Python's kernel into the viewer. And if you don't have OME ZAR, we're gonna get into OME ZAR. So there's support for all different types of data structures that you'll encounter in Python and formats. And if it's not OME ZAR, we generate this multi-scale pyramid again in Python and then send it over. So, and we do visualization based on that data structure. And towards the future, so what's happening now, kind of preview, and what's just work in progress that we're doing is having this architecture of a meta viewer. So much better than anything Facebook could do. But the idea is that this is a viewer that has customizable front ends and customizable renderers. So the heart of the viewer is built on the state machine, and basically you can have the different UI implementations or rendering implementations of the state machine. And that allows you to build your own UI or take one of the existing UI implementations that are native front-end web UIs and make it work like you need to work to integrate into an application or remove things that aren't relevant so you get a more simpler interface for a custom research application. And they could be written in vanilla HTML or frameworks like Vue or React. So one example you see on the top there in this slide, there's two user interfaces. They're actually, one's written in vanilla HTML, one's written in React Material UI. And the example below is an example where we've implemented this idea, developing a application for visualization plugin for TensorBoard, which is a tool if people do AI development for training their systems, they need to do some visualization. But this naturally kind of integrates into the TensorBoard user interface, has the Material UI components used for the UI components, but it's using the same kind of tools in the back end. And we're working towards, we'd like to do, have these customizable renderers too for the purpose of editing or annotating and being able to, one goal would be have Napari or Mobi do the rendering and then sending that as a server-side render. And this work is open source and available, and we really welcome collaboration on it in the community. You can find the relevant code here. That's all I had.
Thanks super a lot, cool. Mattis. Yeah, go ahead, Christian.
Yeah, super cool. Hey, thanks. I have two questions. Maybe start. So are you thinking also to render multiple images at once in the same viewer?
So this registration application, yes. We're looking at bringing together two images and then comparing them. And that's kind of the feature set that we're building out next. And our current renderer that we have the most focus on is VGK.js, a client-side renderer. And one implementation detail is it supports rendering one volume, but how that would be implemented is where you have one of the volumes would be resampled in the same sampling grid as the other volume, and it would show up as another component of the other filtering that would happen to give you the rendering. So yes, with that limitation, at least for the BTK rendering backend. I think if we had something like Mobi, that obviously Yushon has great capabilities for rendering many things together in a nice way.
I think, but I think also actually what's nice now is since we have this standard format, I think we are not anymore in that situation that we need one tool to do everything, right? Yes. I think that's really a game changer, I think, right?
Absolutely.
So I mean, just to say, right, it doesn't have to be, but okay. Yes. And then I have another question. Can I also, let's say I'm on a Linux command line and I have an OME czar, can I just say your thing, view the czar, or is it only a pure web thing, or how is that?
Yeah, that's kind of on the roadmap. So how that is looking to be done is you'll run that. It'll be a Python program, and then it will start up this WebSocket, this Python WebSocket that MJoy supports, and communicate through that. So that would be, and then it would kind of open up a tab in your web browser.
So it would open a tab in the browser. Okay.
Cool. Yeah.
And that would also then work from within the Python script.
Yes. Yes, exactly.
Okay, cool.
Yep. You have two questions in the chat, Matt. I don't know if Guillaume or Ken want to pipe up.
Guillaume, do you want to start? Your question was first.
Yeah, sure. Do you hear me?
Yeah, perfectly.
No, I was wondering, as your hardware, how do you plan or are dealing on meshes, and are they going to be integrated in OME and GFF, or as a separate czar format, or what? I was wondering where that was going.
That's a great question, and I would love to see support for meshes in OME czar, and we'll probably support it in the viewer, but without. As soon as the community comes together with a consensus on how to store that data model, we'll work to support that too. For now, I guess the meshes, we support other formats too. So you can load meshes, but they're not OME czar, but we're looking also to support the kind of the point cloud table spec that's in progress too. That's been done explicitly. Let's get some mesh support in there.
Yeah, I'm working with Emmanuel Faure, who's developing MorphoNet. I don't know if you, and apparently they are talking about coming together with MorphoMetrics or MorphoGraphics, the MorphoGraphics people. They are talking about coming together to get some kind of standard for meshes. So I urge them to use OME and GFF for that. I wanted to know if the community has anything else running for the moment. But thanks for your answer.
Ken, anything from you? You had a question in the chat, or you want to expand as a UI was auto of you?
Sorry, thank you. Thank you, Mai. Our user actually quite interested in. I really love that VTK kind of 3D model, and you have all the slides. But the user actually want to have the traditional, kind of one view, and then you have the orthogonal view. I'm just wondering how easy it is, because you mentioned about it's customizable. How easy is it to customize that? I wonder.
Yes, that's kind of the model of the viewer is this idea, right, of a volume view, but also slice views and supporting that. And that's okay. That's
the model. It's not too difficult, so to speak.
Yes.
To customize that. Okay. Yeah. Nice to hear. Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Thanks a lot, Matt, for this great presentation. So it's not something we could have done ourselves with your input, because there are many things there that I would not even attempt it to show. We have only tested by using the hyperlink. And also thanks for in your presentation, there's list of file and we are collecting those files. Are you happy for us to add them to the list of public sample?
Absolutely, please do, yes.
Yeah, that's great, thanks. So moving on, pass, unless people want to have a 5-minute break because we have got two more presentations to go through. Do people want 5 minutes before? 5-minute break, I see Josh nodding, so.
Let's everyone gonna do like jumping jacks and wake up.
If you're okay, Norman, with that before we go to WebNozzles.
Sure. So, yeah. Please be refreshed for the WebNozzles.
Okay. Yeah. So let's get back in at 10 past the hour, and that give us enough time to stretch our leg and grab a drink of some sort for anybody. And thanks again so far for the great presentation. I've been away for this yoga session, so. We have got, oh, Peter is back. Yeah, good. Peter, so we have two more demonstration. One from Norman, which is going to show us WebNozzles. And after that, Peter Valchesko will show us how the support of Omero for MEZAR. So that's more related to the ZAR reader, how to the file that I get imported into Omero can, what happened and how you can view them in a standard Omero way, I would say. So Norman, please go ahead and excite us again with WebNozzles.
Yeah, it's a high bar. For everybody who was there this morning, I have a slightly different demo this afternoon, so don't tune out. So I thought I'd first show a big data set in WebNozzles. This is not an OMIA GFF data set, but it is to be exported as one, so you can view this data set in any other OMI and GFF compatible tool if you want to. This is EM data from Mouse Cortex. It's been published a couple of years ago by our collaborators at the Max Planck Institute. And yeah, here you can see this is WebNozzles, web-based tool. You can zoom in and out the data very efficiently. It loads quite quickly. You can zoom into look at synapses if you want to. The colors are based from an automated segmentation. WebNozzles has support for rendering these segments out as is. These have been pre-computed on the server, so they load very fast, but we can also create meshes directly from anything that you draw inside of WebNozzles. Then you can also work with that. So WebNozzles primarily is a visualizing tool. You can load these data sets and yeah, they have everything URLs. You can send other people if you want to. It's also a platform where you can store and manage these kind of large data sets if you're working with a team and can manage access controls and stuff like that. But then the second big part that WebNozzles does is allows you to create annotations on top of that. So you can create these segmentation labels, also support for scalarization point annotations. So all of that also works. And again, that's everything works in a sort of a collaborative manner. So you can split up work and merge it together if you want to with your colleagues. But now I wanted to show you how you can work with OMIZAR data in WebNozzles. So for that, we're going to fetch this data set from IDR gallery and I'm going to click add data sets, click this tab here, add remote ZAR or N5 data set, paste in the URL and click on here, add layer. Now I need to provide a name. So let's call this OMI demo. For everybody who was here this morning, we didn't have multi-channel support. Now we do, and I hope it works. So I'm going to import this, and now we can, when it will load, we can actually see the data. The loading speeds obviously also depend a bit on where the data is stored and yeah, and what your own local connection is, and also the chunk size has quite a big impact. Okay, so while this is still loading, I'm just going to give it some color so we can see the different channels. In a future version, we also hope to import this from OMIGF. We had a good discussion about this morning. So yeah, here we are. Load in this data set, if you can browse around. And now I want to show you how you can create annotations on top of that. So just click on this link up there. And I'm just going to work on this red layer right here. So I'm going to, we have this new experimental tool where you can
fill up shapes basically. And so if you just draw around a rectangle and then it fills it up with a flood fill algorithm. I skipped a couple of sections. Now I'm going to use the interpolation feature, so it will fill it up in between. And this will be tricky to fill up, but well, it did something right there. I can save this as autosave, but if I do it manually, I can immediately get the compute meshes right here. So let's get rid of this viewports. And what I just drawn now is a 3D render right here. And if I now continue basically to fill up this cell, the whole cell would be visualizable there. And all of these, so this labeling works inside the browser. Again, you can collaborate on that. Another feature that we've added that is supported by OmniZAR is what we call ZAR links. So you can create these links. They work fairly similar to signed URLs in S3. So you can create them. You can give them an expiration date. And what these will allow you to do is to take the data that you've created in WebNossos or that gets imported to WebNossos into a different tool. And for that, I open up a NeuroGlancer right here. So here we go. This is the data. Let's adjust the histogram so that we actually see something. So this is the color data that gets fed from WebNossos into NeuroGlancer. And we're also going to add the segmentation layer that we did. So I'm going to add another layer here. And our volume, just make sure to select segment. And here you can see the segment showed up. So we don't export the meshes yet to NeuroGlancer because there's not a good interchange format. But once there is a mesh specification, then you can also do that. And yeah, and this works with every other OmniZAR capable tool, of course, and it works not only for data sets that were originally in OmniZAR, but it works for any data set that is stored on WebNossos. And this not only allows you to work with this in other tools such as NeuroGlancer, but you can also work in Python or something. And we have a dedicated WebNossos library, but it's actually just a fairly thin wrapper around the ZAR Python library, so you can load in the data from there and access all the data. And if you want to learn more about that, go to docs.webnos.org and then hit Python library. And there's a couple of examples how you can do how you can get streaming based access to the data sets that are stored on WebNossos. All right. So that's the short demo. Are there any questions? I saw something in the chat. Oh, yeah.
Thanks, Norman. That's great. No, I put the link to the in the chat of the discussion around the rendering because you mentioned that was a discussion. For my, maybe I missed that this morning. What the when you exchange to go to NeuroGlancer the segmentation? So do you mm-hmm. is it just a mask that you're sending? What is the format you are sending in that case to NeuroGlancer? As you alluded, there is no current common language to pass for meshes, but there might be other things like region of interest or mask or anything. So what do you send there?
So it's like a new OMI and GFF data set, but it's not DMAP. So we could also expose that as a label map in OMI and GFF, but I don't think it's a one-to-one representation at this point because we can have multiple of these label images, which I think NGFF supports, but we can also have multiple other layers inside of WebNossos, like for example, the different channels are exposed as separate layers in WebNossos, and I don't think we have something in NGFF there yet, but hopefully that will be something that we can get in via the collections proposal. So we're also would be very happy to work on that.
Great, thanks, Christian.
Yeah, I have a question. Since you can draw labels, that's kind of nice for deep learning, right? do you have any ambition to run bioimage models in WebNossos?
No, absolutely. Well, not no, yes.
No,
absolutely.
Oh.
So we're kind of in the process of laying the groundwork for that. So we've introduced, I think last year, the like a background worker to WebNOS that could run these things and then basically update the segmentation for the browser. And we're in the process of porting our own machine learning pipeline to be better integrated with WebNOSOS. So, and then we'll also, that's also something we have on a roadmap for next year so that you can have this loop, right? So you draw stuff in WebNOSOS, it gets fed into a machine learning training, and then you can run this model on the entire data set. And of course, it would be great to also integrate a bioimage models to this. Yeah.
Because I think we are, I think they are really good now. You can run them in many tools, but I think like then correcting the segmentations and resubmitting for training, I think that's sort of missing. But maybe you can help maybe, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't show this today, but we also have been working quite a lot on segmentation proofreading tools in particular.
Cool.
Especially if you have an over segmentation, then we're now have a graph editor. You can basically just fix splits and merges. With a few clicks.
Oh, cool. Sorry, one more question. And then to actually do this in practice, you would need an S3 bucket with write access probably, right? I mean, that you can save what you did somewhere. Yeah, okay. Okay.
Yeah, we haven't figured out the details of how we want to store the segmentations that get out of that. The annotations that we produce are stored in a database inside of WebNOSOS, like they're the ones you hand draw. They're fairly small, so that's that works quite well. But if we want to run it on very large data sets and produce segmentations, we probably need to store it somewhere else.
Cool.
It's great. One final question for me, Norman, because you mentioned the file is not necessarily into MSR. Is there a limit in terms of how much data people can put into the account when they create the account?
So, I mean, it's a manifold answer to that. So on webnosos.org, we host WebNOSOS, and if you have a free account, there is some limit of how much data you can upload. But if you link in data from a different storage, then basically that doesn't count against your limit, right? So, and then we have paid plans for if you want to increase your storage and you want to upload. Or if you can just run WebNOSOS on your own and then limited by how much your disk can store.
Hmm. Yeah. So that's good. Thanks. Because I forgot to mention that. No, I'm not. I'm not loading. Thousands of data.
No, you could. I mean, people do that. I just had somebody who uploaded.
No, I was just curious because we have seen into our demo server that we kindly offer similar, and then out of a sudden people use and abuse it. And we have to remind them, please stop loading because you reach very quickly the capacity. So that was just curious. Yeah. Before we diverge too much, I think we have one last presentation from my colleague Peter Malchesko. So Peter, unless there is more question for Norman, sorry, I should have asked. Yeah. Thanks again, Norman, for that exciting and bleeding edge from one in the morning to the afternoon changes. And thanks again. It was great. Peter?
So, hello again. Let me show you the last tool demoed today. And this is Omero. I mean, many of you know Omero. It's the main software product of the OME team. And one thing to highlight at the start is it is a little bit exceptional with in comparison with those tools which were demoed up till now, in the sense that Omero is not able to directly open and link from an image from S3 bucket. And what I have to do in order to get the viewing of an OME and GFF in Omero is to import it in the good old Omero way. So I had to download that image from the S3 bucket. You can see here onto some file system. And I have here two OME and GFFs, and I will now import them into Omero. Let us construct the import command. So you can see that it says Omero import, which is probably something which you saw already, or if you ever imported into Omero using the command line interface. By the way, Omero Insight is not ready yet to import OME and GFFs into Omero, so it's exclusively a command line interface workflow. First of all, I have here a flag saying depth 10, which means that the bioformats should scan deeper into the hierarchy of directories, at least 10 levels. This is because OME and GFFs have many subdirectories, as you probably know. And then I am setting for convenience a name so that we can easily recognize that image after import into Omero. By default, it would tend to have not very telling names. This is a flag which indicates that inside Omero, the image will be imported into a dataset, which is basically a container inside Omero called OME-NGFF. Well, and this is the OME-NGFF, which I'm going to import, the 499.5.228.zar. So let's just start the import. First of all, I will be encouraged to log into Omero, like so. And now you will see in a second that those single chunks are flying by, being imported into Omero. It went quite well and fast. The file set was imported. Quite a few files were uploaded, which were then resulting in one single image, which was imported. Now I will go to the Omero web. And this is, as you can maybe remember, the name of the data set I was flagging on my command line command to import into. And I have to refresh the Omero web so that I can see the fresh import. Now I have two images in that data set. And this is the 499.5.228 OME-ZAR, which I've just imported in front of your eyes. And now this is also having a thumbnail in the central pane, as you normally would, and the image can be treated as very normal image imported into Omero, such as I can open it in iViewer as I just did using a double click, and then I can adjust the rendering settings, let's say get rid of this very strong green background and a little bit pop up the rendering to see better the blue and the red channels. This is obviously a single Z and single T image, but the Omero of course supports the 5D image, which is multi-channel, multi-Z and multi-T. And this is not different for OME and GFFs. So I could have imported a multi-Z and multi-T, but obviously I didn't do it for the interest of time. The thing which you have to be careful about is that the naming of the channels and their colors are not being respected. This is because Omero does not read the metadata from the OME and GFF file in this case. And we can discuss it later if you want to understand this in detail. The other image which I have in Homero want to show you is an image which was already shown by the VTK demonstration, the very nice VTK demonstration, and it's a large image. I have imported it previously, and it's of course pyramidal levels, and you can view it and browse it as you normally would large images in Homero iViewer. Okay, and the feature I'm actually demonstrating here, which is basically powering all of what I'm doing, beginning from the import and ending by reading the single tiles here, is the new reader in bioformats called ZAR reader. Okay, and you can get this ZAR reader with, of course, accompanying ability to import and view OMI NGFFs in Homero by simply upgrading your Homero to the latest version. Now, let me go back to the Homero web client to persuade you that I indeed am working with OMI NGFFs. You know from this image, I imported it in front of you. About this image, I can go to the right-hand pane and click on the file paths icon, and this expands the file set info and other information where I can click on show more, and I can see the paths of the single chunks which were imported into Homero, such as this one here. And with that, I think I would like to finish the presentation. Thank you for your attention. And I'm passing the word back.
Thanks, Peter, for the great presentation. So there were a few questions that have been answered in the chat. So yeah, the file is treated like any file. But maybe Sebastian, because that's the point that Peter made about the file need to be currently imported. That's obviously something we are exploring in the context of IDR. Do you want to expand on that? Because we have obviously large data set study that have already been converted into ZAR that are available on S3, and there's no need to remove them, move them back into Homero or into IDR. So do you want maybe to expand what is the process there that we're currently looking into?
So yeah, and this probably is a conversation that's not just about NGFF and software, but also storage. And probably that's a conversation that many of you might have at your institution at some point. So the IDR problem, which probably is faced by many others, is that there's a limited pool of NFS, in that case, storage, which is the one that's been used historically. So we're being pushed towards using like other sources of data. So at the moment, what we have is an S3-like, so it's has the S3 protocol. It's not Amazon S3, but some object storage that's available to us thanks to the collaboration with Matthew Hartley from the Bioimage Archive. I don't think Matthew is here tonight.
He's not here this afternoon.
And yeah, so the goal is to actually start leveraging both of these. So essentially data that's been converted to NGFF, or actually more and more like new data set data submitted to us in the NGFF format. So there are submitters who we are actively working with who have been making the effort to submit the data in NGFF. That will be stored, that will be stored in this kind of object storage capability of Embol EBI. So at the moment, what is completely lacking, so Homero does not know how to talk natively to object storage. So there is no, I can talk directly to S3. The workaround which we're exploring, and so far it looks like it's kind of fairly promising under some assumption, is you can essentially mount your S3 bucket essentially on your system, make it appear as like any other kind of file system mount. There are a few libraries which allow to do that. People might throw links in the chat, but S3FS used to be the canonical library. We're using this library, which is called Goofies or GoofiesFS. I don't know how to pronounce it, which has similar capabilities. Once you have that, essentially your data, which is in object storage, becomes available to your server, and you can use exactly the workflow that Peter has demonstrated to kind of import data on the server. You can do in-place import, the data just sits on S3, and you make a number of calls internally, which are through this library to make it look like it's on the file system. So that's pretty much what we're exploring at the ideal level at the moment. Hopefully this will come into production early 2023. Still details to be ironed out especially with the Biometric Archive team. Once we've reached that milestone, there's probably going to be a second question of when Omero can talk natively to object storage. But I think that's, I don't have any demo here, but that's really one step beyond what Peter had shown you, which is the classical Omero import where the data sits on the same file system so that you can actually start importing from S3 buckets. Over.
Thanks, Seb, for the great overview. Any question for Seb? So I think one point that was raised this morning and Will wanted to demonstrate that is how do we have some, if someone has some sample data, how to convert some of those data into ZAR to take advantage of those great viewer we have seen. So Will is going to quickly demonstrate a tool that have been developed by Lenco software, the NGFF converter. Will, do you want to demo? Because that's something we were asked this morning, so we thought it would be good to show it in action. So that's a desktop, a GUI tool. Go ahead, Will. You're muted.
Yeah, thanks. So this is a GUI tool to wrap the bioformats to raw tool, which can also be used directly on the command line. This is just a slightly nicer UI. So if you download this tool and open up that the tool, this is the UI you'll get, and it's a very simple case then of dragging a file that you want to convert into this queue. So I'm using an example here that actually it contains multiple images. This is a Zeist MDB. And you can drag a bunch of items into the queue here. The type of file, it can convert either to OMB NGFF or to OMB TIFF. I think the default is NGFF. This case, I've got an output folder already specified. I think the default is just to use the same directory that you uploaded to. But I'm just going to, so let's look at the, so I'm going to get output to this folder here. And you'll see when I run this. So I've chosen a relatively small file so that it's pretty quick for a demo. And this is created this directory here, and it's now done. So this, as I mentioned earlier, this creates the bioformats to raw layout. So each of the containers within it is in OMI NGFF image, and the container contains a bunch of these images as well as the metadata here. So currently just to show what that looks like in the validator, I'm just serving these files locally from a local Python process here, which serves it from that directory. And that's just running here. But what I can do then is go to my browser. I'm actually going to show a different one of this. I'm going to show this example NDPI here. It's a slightly nicer view, but you'll see it has the same structure. And so this is what it's. I'm just browsing this local, and as I said before, we've got this layout, which wraps these various images. And again, I'm going to open one of these images in Vizar. And yeah, so this is viewing quite a large image just coming from locally. So I should one thing I should point out that's in the validator here, if I open this individual image, is that this is version 0.2 of the OMI-NGFF spec that is currently exported by BioFormats to RAW. So you'll see it's missing some of the axes metadata. So what you're seeing in Vizar here is really just the three channels are currently shown separately. It doesn't know that these are three channels. But I expect that to be, that'll be updated. So that's how we've generated a lot of the samples that we've been working with. I just super quickly show you how we've been generating some other samples, which is a command line Omero plugin. Called Omero CLI ZAR. And if you have that pip installed on your command line, you can simply do Omero ZAR export and point it to the image ID. I'm already logged into the service. So, and I'm in the same directory I was before. Oh, I'm not logged in. So that's simply going to take the image ID and export it to a by default, just exports it to an image name to the, with the same ID. And see that appearing. So that's that would have appeared here. And I can view that again if I replace this. Okay, so that's the, and this is a 0.4. It contains the rendering information, that sort of thing, so that will show up much more with the expected rendering settings in Vizar and Pari. Okay, I think that's all I was going to show. Thank you.
Thanks, Will. So all the questions in the chat have been more or less answered, I think, except the one from Jeff around the Omero Insight for import. So in its current form, yeah, we are pull requests to import directly from Omero Insight the OMI NGFF. But any work on the next generation, is it Qt Python? Do you want to expand on that? Are you thinking of a new client to import data? Is that what you're suggesting?
Well, no, basically I was wondering if there is any work being done on it, and I was just wondering if a more modern GUI might be more interesting, or you know, what's since Omero seems to be working more towards Python. Yeah,
from our side, we have not done anything on the importing as a client on that front, certainly not. So, and if Jason was here, I think it has tried hard to get some funding about upgrading the software stack to something modern, and the answer is, well, you have something that works, so why do you want to change? So that's the kind of the answer we get in a short. So it's very tricky, I would say, in that vein, from people funding the work to find justification for that. Yes, JK has been in maintenance mode. We fixed mainly bugs, and I've added the feature for NGFF, but we do not had for Insight, we do not had any more key feature that we add in the web, for example. Like you have the figure making in the web that for people that know about Omero, you can generate a lot of figures. That's not something we want to do in the desktop client. we will certainly move away from even finding another mechanism to import, probably more web approach for importing data, like similar to what WebNosis has, and pushing towards a desktop client for multiple reasons. But here, even in our institute, is distributing the application can at times be problematic, you know, within the various hurdles that anybody has to go through into an institution to package a software and distribute it on control machine. So I think we have the last 15 minutes. So far for the whole discussion, it looks like what is needed for many people is the support for metadata. And I think that's the topic of the third day that Josh is going to guide us through. So from a viewer perspective, people developing viewer, we discussed a few things this morning, but for unfortunately Christian has to go, but from Matt and Paul's perspective, is there anything that will be needed from a NGFF perspective? So we discussed this morning rendering settings, but you seem otherwise to ITKS what they need, or will be support for region of interest, or mesh will be the next step from your perspective, I imagine.
Yes, I agree. The mesh and the rendering settings, that's really interesting too. And I saw you pointed to an issue. Is there any other thoughts or
I think
what's the extent of that?
For the issue for the rendering is something we looked at a various tool at the time, which was the our usage, the Big Data Viewer and other. So if you have some needs there, so the specification was put out almost a year ago and we didn't come top of the list at the time. But if there is some element we have potentially missed in that specification from your perspective, that will be great to have your input there. So please feel free to add anything there. And I think the mesh issue that was created by Guillaume a while back, but as always, putting the specification in takes a bit of time and have to be accepted by all. Yeah, as I said, so far we have looked at the viewer we were aware of, and they trying to catch up what's needed. So if something is missing, just please add comment and we can evolve that that specification. Yes, Norman, you had a hand raised?
Yeah, I just wanted to second that. Basically, I think for us, meshes would be very interesting, collections as well. And of course, rendering settings, we discussed that, I think, this morning enough. Yeah, and then many more. I mean, all of these tables and point annotations and segment annotations are also very, very, very interesting.
So, yes, Jean-Karim?
Just maybe before we wrap up, I just wanted to ask if anybody was working on wrapper for R, especially for the or interactivity for the R viewer. I'm thinking of the ITK thing. So they mentioned a Python binding, but especially because now what I mean, I just want to bring it here to people who are maybe not aware is that we are bridging more and more with bioinformatics people with all these single cell approaches, and they tend to work with a mix of Python and R, but a lot of time there's a bit of work done in R, and would be actually cool to be able to link to the images from the R side, not having to switch to something else. So just
some few consideration.
I would work on this if I had more resources or more time, but so I just can't do it at the moment.
So a few kind of status updates from my side, Jean Karim. There was an attempt to get some funding for that. That didn't happen from another project. As far as I know, the most movement from the bioconductor community, so I ended up joining their Slack and they did a bunch of talking and I helped where I could, sending them demo data. Was to use the Python wrapper. So R wrapping Python was kind of where they were happy to be. I can't say how solid of a solution that is. There are a couple of
in my experience. That's why this reticulate thing is always causing problems. I think it's just because of the way Python works. But so I'd rather have a Java wrapper because the Java bridge is much more robust, although not without issues. But yeah, just basically wondering if there was any work in that direction for the viewers also.
So I don't know of anyone working with a Java, so bridging to Java, but that might be something we could try. I know of like, I think three repos where they have started implementations and not completed them. So maybe we could jump on board on one of those. And then the final point from my side is there's a growing movement. Maybe movement's too strong, at least a feeling that there should be some shared native libraries. So maybe not that the entire implementation is shared, like from a libc or a libzar style library, but that at least certain large components could be written natively and then shared amongst the implementations. So when and if that happens, it might make developing some of these libraries that have begun much simpler.
Yeah.
So from our side, you certainly have our support, and we'll, you know, every time it comes up, I try to help as much as I can. Yeah. But so far, no one has picked up the banner and said, I'm going to implement this, right?
Yeah, I started and then just had too many other things. And then I just, yeah, don't have the time to do it myself. And then people working with me also busy. So we don't have the resources. So I just want to bring it up for people to still be aware that there's still a need, maybe not as great as the from the Python community, but still there.
Thanks. Anything you want to add, Matt, because ITK was
mentioned. Yeah. I was wondering, as a follow-up, programming it directly in R, if we can get that, that's great. How much is, because I don't do too much work myself in R. I know a lot of folks use R Shiny. And is that, like, if we get some visualization support,
so that would be actually cool one thing. So interacting with the Shiny package for the website of things, that would be actually great. We have applications along that line. The other aspect would be just simply some sort of R package that wraps a C or C++ library or a Java one. But wrapping Python with this reticulate package is a bit of a mess and leads to all kinds of problems most of the time.
Valeria, your hand up.
Oh, hi, thank you. I just wanted to second that there is a very large community. And right now, I think the issue is that the bioinformaticians working in R are extracting the data from an image and then not going back to the image to validate if the data is true or not after they've done all their processing. And at that point, it becomes very opaque what they're doing, because the biologists want to validate with the image because they can read the image very well and they cannot read the statistical tools very well. And so you're just kind of blindly believing what the stats are telling you. So just wanted to reiterate that there is a really large amount of data that's flowing from imaging right directly into R, and we're not being able to see it on the other end.
Yeah, that's thanks for the valuable comment. That's Valeria. And so there was any more comment on the topic? So I think we have 5 minutes to spare. So I would like to thank again everybody for this great presentation. It was very useful and inspired many people, I think. And what is possible, and I think Ken will have plenty of ideas now of what he wants to do and what his users are going to ask him. So it was great. So we'll point to, because there were some more presentation than this morning because of the time difference, people will attend, so we'll advertise where it is if people are interested in I2K or Mobi or even the new Webnosis. We'll just try to truncate some video and highlight that to the this morning participants. So thanks again from all of us, and it was great discussion. So yeah, I think that's, and metadata will be on for people who have been asking plenty of metadata. That will be Josh and Tuesday morning start, I think, 8 o'clock. So if you're interested and want to know how metadata will be supported, or at least which metadata will be, let's join Josh and team on Tuesday morning at 8 o'clock our UK time, or 4 o'clock UK time. So thanks again, and talk to you later. Bye-bye.
Take care.
Thank you, Jean-Marie. Bye-bye.